thank you for stopping by. Definitely would like to share our journey, what we are doing at NetApp regarding our cloud and DevOps. I am Enterprise Cloud Architect at NetApp IT. And in the next 10 minutes, I want to give you a cloud strategy. It's like too much to cover, but I think it will still meaningful discussions. If you like it, we'll be here to discuss more and zoom into the areas where you would like to zoom into. But idea is, here we talk about how we are doing at cloud in NetApp IT. This is the IT to discussion for the folks who joined in, and nothing marketing or producty or salesy about it. But idea is, if you look at any IT organization, they're always in two modes, right? They have to keep the business running, and they also have to transform the business. So when do you have to keep the business running? These are, you have to close your book, you have to run your payroll, you have to run email. So you have different sets of requirements and priorities over there. And then at the same time, you have to make sure you make your customers more happier, your products have more efficiencies, you are able to deliver the features at the speed that the business needs. So that's your transform the business, right? The goals over here is make it simple. So you really don't have to have an army of developers, you're not doing too much customization, you're not spending too much money, you are more of a fulfillment role over here. Here, you have to be agile, you have to be more of innovative, you have to be more of a nimble organization to say, hey, the business wants this, how soon or fast I can get this into the hands of my customers. So that's the two modes, right? And idea is cloud works in both of them. You can do SaaS over here, or you could build the whole stack over here, so you have full control of the stack. So you need to have a strategy around what is the workload you're trying to do, which model it fits in, and what is your cloud strategy regarding that, right? So everything in NetApp or IT should start with a strategy. It's not, if you're doing cloud because it's a role or it's a goal in your CIO checklist, it's not going to go too far, right? The idea is you want to say, here's my strategy, here's why I'm doing cloud, here's the benefits I want to get out of it, and how do my workload maps against that strategy. So that's how we are starting, and that brings to our big strategy slide. We at NetApp have multiple models we run all our applications through to determine what is the right target state architecture for each of our applications. By target state architecture, it could be, do we build it on-prem, or do we put it in SaaS? Or even if we build it on-prem, how much of a cloudiness we do? Do we do microservices to it? Do we just do rehosting? Do we do infrastructure as a service? So those are all the things you have to decide based on your workload category, right? So we start on the left to say, all right, let's rationalize all our apps. What are they doing? Are they helping us innovate? Or are they helping us differentiate from your customers? Yeah, those are the apps where you need to be on the lower side of the previous slide, right? I need to be nimble, fast, innovative, and things like those. If it's a commodity app or if it's a system of records app, I need to be more, okay, let's do fulfillment, get a SaaS solution out there, make sure our needs are fulfilled, and if it is, it's good, right? So we kind of have about 375 applications in our portfolio. Each one of them is mapped into that category. Once we map into that category, the next step is, where does it fit in the time machine, right? It's T-I-M-E. All right, it's a tolerate application. We are going to just tolerate it because the functionality it's giving, it's short-lived, it's going to go away, or it's not critical enough. Eliminate, yeah, it's already done. It's just going out. And invest is the applications where are still good and the business uses it, and we want to continue to invest in that. And migrate are, yeah, they are critical, but they're not on the right stack where we want to be, right? So a couple of outcomes from this is, this helps us build consensus across the organization, including IT and business. Yeah, we all agree that's the right categorization, and we agree the strategy. Everybody agrees tolerate, okay, we are going to only touch it if something breaks. Everybody agree this is migrate, yeah, we're going to work on it and put it into the right. So it builds, if you have a documented policy like this, it brings the whole organization on the same page. And then it also gives you a focus, right? You don't have to do anything about these three. These two are going to die. This is in the right spot. Let's talk about how do we migrate this, right? So we have to migrate this from, and this migrate is not from the word, okay, move it from on-prem to cloud. This is, you have to migrate to a technology. It could be a SaaS, could be a migration, right? Exchange was on-prem. Now we think Office 365 is the right thing to do. Yeah, migrate to the right target state architecture. So once we have determined these applications, the next level is where to, right? And then we have something we call in our model, what is called 5 R's. What R is this particular migrate app fits to? It could be replace, okay, go to SaaS. It could be rebuild, where we are doing everything like microservices, DevOps, and containerization, all those things, because these are your crown jewels. And this thing you are after here is, I want to be able to deliver fast. I want to be very nimble. I want to be able to do DevOps and automation so I can give fast results to my business and to my customers. So you kind of categorize your crown jewels in here. So if you have 375 applications and all of them are mapping here, you're doing something wrong. This should be like maybe 10% or 15% where your business really depends on. It could be the Netflix app for Netflix. It could be ActiveIQ for NetApp, or it could be your crown jewels where you really make the difference, right? And then you go from there to say, yeah, what's the re-architect, refactor, rehost? At a bare minimum, any infrastructure we want to provide has to be automated infrastructure as service. So that's the minimum level of entry we want to do in the cloud. Everything else beyond is what do you want to do? So what's our strategy? Always start with app rationalization. Make sure you have, you know where your apps are and what they're doing for you. You want to make sure any common business process, and what we mean by common business, email, NetApp uses the same way Google uses email or any other company uses. There's no real benefit or innovation or strategy around email. So that's a common business process. First option, put it on the SaaS. DevOps and innovation for innovative and strategic apps, right? These are the differentiators where we can differentiate from our competitors, right? That's where we want to do DevOps. And idea is DevOps is not natural. You have to build automation, you have to do CI/CD pipelines, you have to build a tool structure, you have to write a lot of automation to make it happen. So if you are putting that kind of effort, you need to make sure you have the value, right? Because this has the most number of effort. You have to break an app and convert that into containers and microservices and stuff like this. So you have to have a value statement behind the effort you put over there, right? So idea is DevOps where it matters. Anything new, which is non-SaaS or non-common business process, you want to start with DevOps, right? You don't want any more technology depth coming into your IT organization. If it is new, yeah, start the right way, because there are tools and technologies available to do right, even though wherever it fits in. And last, as we said, IaaS as a bare minimum, right? Infrastructure service as a bare minimum for every workload. So that's our very quick level picture of what the IT strategy at NetApp and most companies should look like. And hopefully it resonates with you guys too, and something you guys can bring to your organizations too. So from the perspective, once the categorization done, this is the easy part, right? So everything which is common business process goes to SaaS, and anything which is the build part, right? So we have buy versus build. So this is we are buying, and this is we are building. So in building, the approach we are taking is we, as an NetApp IT, are the DevOps platform. So our approach is we are going to provide a platform to all our app owners that they can come and be able to deliver any type of app they want. If they just want IaaS, if they want re-architect, or they want rebuild, the platform should be able to deliver those services in an on-demand, self-service, as a cloud provider type model, right? So that's essentially what we're building. So two modes. We are taking the role at IT as a platform ops, and all the developers can come and plug in their applications on top of that. So if you look at this red, actually, yeah, just to summarize, right? So here's where all the NetApp technology comes in. And here, that's the only slide I have with NetApp products, and you can use whatever products works best for you on your side. But idea is, on the private cloud side, we are using NetApp's HCI, All Flash FAS, and Storage Grid. These are the hyper-converged infrastructure NetApp makes. This is the object storage used for all cloud-aware type applications. And then you have a flash type storage, which heavy-duty workloads you can put on databases and things like those. In the cloud, we are the only provider which have storage connected into these three clouds. And you can talk to all the product managers what cloud volumes are, how we can use, and storage type, right? So essentially, it's kind of best of both worlds, at least from my perspective, how I see it. You have 25 years of storage innovation tied with elasticity of the cloud, and it gives you best of both options out there, right? So idea is, from our perspective, we have build versus buy. So your build is here. This is what we call as next-gen data center. Our definition for data center has changed. It's no longer the four walls we used to call. It's anywhere out of these clouds, wherever you get the resources at the price point and in the feature and functionality you desire, right? So that's essentially your data center now. Idea is you need to have a strategy of what goes here, how do you use it, how do you make this guy's more cloudy, and how do you elongate the life of your data center by using resources what are making more sense over here. So from our definition perspective, it's a software-controlled, orchestrated development environment which our developers can use to build cloud-aware type applications. And we were surprised or even happy to see when we did all the rationalization, we are seeing that 75% of our apps are common business processes. And over the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to put all of them in SaaS. And these are the 25% where we really want to put the effort in making sure they have the tool chains, they have the pipelines, they have the automation, they have the scripting to be able to deliver the efficiencies what we need. So idea is have a clear segregation and differentiation between what goes where and what's the stack and technology you need to deliver those kind of applications. So if I zoom more further into the left box, this is all the tools what we have in NetApp or at part of the platform which we give to our developers so they can deliver and build these kind of applications, right? So these are the six pillars we can categorize them into. First is, of course, containerization. This is really good if you are in the rebuild category. You want to make sure instead of using VMs, you go to a container model. You have things like Kubernetes which are orchestrating your containers. You have config management. Everything you do is a code, like in terms of what my application should look like, what kind of coloring it should come in, all our runbooks and playbooks, either in Ansible or Helm. So that's a lot of state now in code. For source management, if you have to do version management, if you go to go from back to forth, if you have to roll back an application, if you roll forward an application, even the code or blueprints, if you're doing version management, you have to make sure that's stored in some Git, and you can have all those repos available to you to do those kind of things. CI/CD, definitely all how developers can lifecycle manage their applications all the way from development to stage to prod. You would have tools like Selenium or Jenkins and Azure DevOps is what we are using. Of course, all the infrastructure where all the technologies runs in. And then last but not least, making sure you are monitoring it, you have metrics defined for it, and you are able to do things like, okay, what is my release cadence? What is my feature cadence? How fast I am delivering? Those kind of things are what will define how mature your development or DevOps organization is. So you need to have those kind of metrics and analysis you do at the end of the game, and that's what goes as input back into the cycle to say, how can we get better in next round? How do we make sure it gets to the next level? What does it mean to be NGDC? That all everything we talked about has to be end-to-end integrated with each other, right? So in our platform, our developers really don't have to chase any of the security or any of the infrastructure team to say, hey, give me infrastructure because I'm starting a new dev cycle or I'm starting a new security posture or whatnot. It's all available to them, integrated with the tool sets they are very familiar to use, like Git or VSTS and whatnot, right? So if they upload a source code in their version management, it automatically spins up the environment and thinks what they need to do the testing done and the results delivered to them. So idea is, these are the guys who are actually ultimately developers, are delivering value to the business. And we want to make sure their time is 100% spent in coding versus doing all the regular ops tasks like getting the systems up and configuring it and stitching it together and things like those, right? So first step is, make sure you define where you're going to do DevOps because it's not natural as we take, there's a lot involved in it. So you have a clear strategy. And once you have defined that, you want to make sure this is efficient enough so developers are really using the tools and stuff they are all day in day using and developing their applications using that. Of course, developing all the CI/CD pipelines and their automated workflows in your tool, modernizing your application stack with microservices and containers. And then last but not least is this is an operating model, right? You have to do this for every application and how do you do and make sure you have an operating model which goes and delivers that state what you are after. So with that said, even for maturity level, right, we have defined what are the levels of maturity we need to be at the DevOps. In some DevOps cycle, you could just do manual builds and manual releases and manual testing. That's ad hoc. There's no DevOps in here, but it's still acceptable if your speed is not what you're after, right? If you're releasing some features once in 3 years in your app, you might be at level one. But if you are at level five, which means you're making changes, releasing features for your crown jewels at every day, maybe. So if you look at Netflix and Amazon, they're releasing 1,000 lines of code in production every day, which has all that automated testing, automated builds, automated deployments as part of the automated pipelines and lifecycle. So depends on where your app is and how mature your app is. You need to make sure what kind of strategy you want to apply to which app, right? Did you get that one? Sorry. Okay. So depends, right? It's kind of chaos. We still able to do it. And it's not a bad strategy if you are if your app doesn't need the speed. But if you need the speed, and speed is the name of the game, then you want to be on the lower side of the metrics, right? Continuous integration or delivery or deployment, and you have things what you want. Like, we have defined, this is this level of capabilities your app should have to be defined as at this category. And even from a strategy perspective, you need to take the time to say, which app for me, which fits in which buckets of my DevOps maturity, and go after it to make sure you have the right architecture and tools and framework deployed to deliver that maturity. Here's how we break in IT the workflows, and we have automated, taken the time to deploy all automated workflows in IT. So our developers can go do their day one stuff when they're going in, clicking into our catalog and requesting a comprehensive development environment, right? They say, I need a new app. I want to start developing something. Go to our catalog, request an app. The app pops up. The workspace pops up, right? So all the tools which come together to deliver them a workspace or a host space where they can start developing their code. So it's all integrated. They just do one click over there. Everything else happens behind the scene as a workflow. So it gives you them all the stacks they need. Maybe they need Redis, they need Apache, they need WordPress, LAMPStack, whatever code they need for the stack is available to them to consume. They have all the authorization they need. Okay, I can do resets, I can do reboots, I can do changes. So all the authorization is already set using their usernames and workflows in our single sign-on and IAM type deployments. They get all the spaces created wherever their space is in Amazon or Google Cloud where their stacks are going to be deployed. And then they get all the pipelines, what they need to get the code deployed in the organization. So day one, you are ready up. Now what you need is just to upload a quick code and you should be ready to start your app, right? So once you have the namespace created, you go and say, yep, here's my code and I'm ready to get the application started. The code is inputted. All the lifecycle management, which happens, like how the code moves from dev to test to production, is all fully automated behind the scenes, right? So you would have the code uploaded. The integration server would see there is a change in the code, build up your development environments, run automatic tests against it. If the test pass, it goes to the next stage. If it fails, just let the developer know, yeah, you have to start coding again. So all the amount of time he used to take to build the environments and contact the test team to run the testing is all gone. It's now all automated behind the scenes. So he has, within few hours, or even depending on how much test he has to run, know that, yeah, whether I need to go to next or I need to go recode again. And the beauty about this is also the environment he just spun up is only on demand spun up for him. He's not hogging on to a development environment or resources forever, right? Even a lot of time what we see is app teams would have environment for a year and they do only coding or development for one month, right? So idea is this comes up, the results are given, and this blows away. And then, yeah, if you're ready again, the high cycle starts again. And then you go between phases, right? You go from development to stage to production and all in an automated fashion. Different types of tests you're running here, different type of tests you're running here, different checks you're doing here, different validation like unit testing, functional testing. You're doing all LNP and regression, and then here you are validating the final deployment. But the goal is to make sure you have all of those end-to-end automated. So developers are just saying, hey, I am just coding. Everything else for what is the regression or progression behind it is all fully automated end-to-end. So, yeah, I think if you look at few of our apps, right, I'm just going to build it real quick, right? So, idea is this is a traditional app, this is an agile app, and this is a DevOps app. So, the rate at which they're releasing is much higher as you are in the lower bracket, right? Idea is you are making smaller changes, and you're releasing them as fast as possible in production. So, the time to value is very short. If I decided I want to add this capability to my app, I would really code it, I would run the cycles like those. If it passes, go release it. If it is here, we are doing more of weekly or monthly type releases. Here, we are doing more waterfall, where 3 months, quarterly, and stuff like this. And this is, again, not wrong answer for any app, right? If your app is something which is not needing the speed, you really don't want to invest in getting these levels. But if your app is really where you want to shine out and differentiate yourself from your competitors, you want to be here. So everything has to have a strategy. If you have an effort, you have to have a value statement next to it. This is the effort I'm putting, this is the value I'm after, and have metrics and processes to make sure you kind of track that value, did you get out or not. So just key takeaways from the perspective. I don't know how we're doing on time, but yeah. So this is the key takeaway from our perspective, right? When we are doing cloud journey, what we are after is everything we want to deliver in IT, we want to deliver as a service, which means you're not getting technology from us. You're getting a service from us. You should be able to spin up on your demand. You should be remove on your demand. And it is managed and delivered and tracked and metered as a service, just like how you'd get it from any other cloud provider. Everything you do has to have a strategy and a value statement behind it. If you're doing it for checkmarking a goal, definitely it's not going to go too far. You might say, hey, I have cloud strategy. I'm doing cloud, but okay, what are you getting out of it? It's still questionable, right? Empower developers, because those are the guys who are ultimately delivering value to the business. And you want to make sure as much distraction as you want to remove out from their plate is what is all automation and DevOps and CI/CD around, right? So you want to focus on those areas. Cloud-aware application and capabilities are not necessary for DevOps. How you do containerization, microservices are not necessary for DevOps, but those are getting you the next level of efficiency. If you want to be on the lower level of your maturity curve, these are the type of things you would have to build in your app so you can release really faster. Your fault domains are reduced. You are able to have all development teams work in their isolations and on their cadence versus depending on each other. And that would give you the small lean type deployment models versus waiting on big windows for releases and whatnot. And of course, embrace change and failures, right? If the idea is fail fast and adapt fast, right? That's the whole idea of this thing. A developer knows really quick, I have failed, I'm going to start all over again, versus after 2 months of building the infrastructure and running the test, oh, my code didn't work, and then start again. So failure is part, it should be accepted, but the idea is how fast can you fail and go to and find out whether it's something you want to do or not want to do. And again, it's a long journey. We have so many apps to work on and things keep changing. You would have new providers coming in, new technology coming in. So whole idea is how do you have the culture of embracing changes and failures at the same time be ready for a long journey, which means what operating model you want to put in place to be able to deliver these services to your customers. All right, thank you.